Folks, hello and welcome to Tavern Chat. I am your host, Eric Tenkar, your bartender in the Avatar. And today we are talking 1D&D. Actually, we're talking rumors that myself and Bad Mike have heard from numerous individuals, numerous sources. We're not going to name the sources because we want our sources to remain viable in the future. So I'm labeling this a rumor, but this core part, I don't believe it's a rumor at all. I believe it's true. So let's see what we're talking about. Well, first, here's the history of what or a little background on what 1D&D is. It's going to be the successor to 5e. And what is 1D&D? Well, 1D&D is the code name for the future of D&D. Keep that in mind. D&D rules. We're updating and expanding the rules of the game, and we're looking for your feedback to help shape them. D&D Beyond. Digital Toolset joined the Wizards of the Coast family in 2022. Why? Because they want to keep all this in-house. They want to be the ones making the profits off this. And we want to make it even better. And lastly, Digital D&D Play Experience. Announced during Wizards Presents, D&D Digital is an immersive tabletop space that is in early development. This is what they want. They want to have control over D&D. Right now, with the open game license, there is no control over D&D. Sure, if you sell your products via the DM's Guild, I guess, how much is it goes to Wizards of the Coast? Roughly 25-30%. But it's like 20% going out to drive-thru. I'm sure they want more than that share, but they're not getting a share of Frog God. Frog God has a new adventure out on Indiegogo. It's just for 5e. It's an actual campaign. They're not getting a penny from that, right? Trollord Games put down 5e products. They're not getting a penny from that. Goodman Games puts out something for 5e, you know, one of those classics. Well, they're licensing it, but if it's written for 5e and it's not being sold through the DM's Guild, they're not getting their share. So, what I have heard, what Mike and I have heard, and I'm sure a few others have heard, and I was predicting this, is that the OGL is going to go away. Now, when I say it's going to go away, it's going to go away like it did for 5e. Remember, initially 5e was how long? 15 months before we actually had an OGL. First, you were told, well, you got the free basic rules and just be happy with that shit. And people weren't. And I'm not talking as a 5e player. I'm just talking as a gamer in general. The open game license was something that they did not initially want to put out. Now, why is the open game license important? Well, it's important because it makes third-party publishers find the market for 5e to be viable to support. It's important because Wizards of the Coast does not have the in-house team to produce the amount of content that's being consumed. Okay. What happened over the intervening years? Since 5e came out and they finally relented in giving an OGL, remember, again, wasn't out there initially, and I think 5e really blossomed when the OGL came out. Well, here's the issue. D&D Beyond showed that, hey, you can have digital products come out and work with your physical books. And DM's Guild was, holy shit, we can get money from everything that's published in the DM's Guild. Whether it's us putting out reprints, I say us, which is the Coast, or whether it's, Alan Hammock and Ed Greenwood working on a product together and selling it through the DM's Guild, or it's Joe Schmo selling it through the DM's Guild, they're getting a cut of every sale, and that's an important part. It's evergreen money, right? And once you're in that environment, you're locked in. You can't say, all right, well, I'm going to make a Castles of Crusades version or an OSE version or a Swords of Wizardry version. Can't do it. If you're in the DM's Guild, your product, Tenkar's Tenkenkuous Dungeons. I wrote it for 5e. and I put it into the DM's guild, guess what? It doesn't leave. I can't do an OSC version. I can't do a Swords and Wizardry Continual Light version. Just can't. The contract doesn't allow it. Now, one D&D. We've been promised, or 5e gamers have been promised, that it'll be backwards compatible, meaning that you can take your one D&D rule set and still run 5e adventures with it. That's awesome. That's great. It does not mean that you're going to be seeing new 5e content being made to be run with one D&D, because one D&D is going to have new rules, right? Updating and expanding the rules of the game. So to be one D&D compatible, it's going to require something different. It's going to require an SRD. I have, on good authority, been informed that there will be an SRD for one D&D. However, that license, that system resource document, will be under license. And it's not going to be an open game license. Now, I am not quite sure. My sources aren't quite sure. I'm not sure they've hacked all this stuff out yet. Whether it's going to be a license similar to the game system license, which fucking tanked, which, I mean, I don't suspect it's going to be that. You know, the game system license, you got to pay a couple thousand dollars to publish for a game that many may not really care about that much. I don't see that. And why not? Also, because that's one and done. You pay your $5,000 and Wizards of the Coast is not going to see money coming from you again unless it's a yearly fee or whatever. It isn't enough to justify it. And it also keeps the hobby publishers out. And these hobby publishers are generating a lot of money through DM's Guild. So I suspect the license will be through the DM's Guild. In other words, if you want to write for one D&D, you will need to publish your work through the DM's Guild. It's an interesting thing that comes out of that, though, right? Because it literally locks that material into one D&D, right? You can't publish it outside. And it might not be DM's Guild as it is now, you know, because we've seen Wizards of the Coast wants to own all of their partners in the case. Could they buy out OBS? Possibly. Could they buy out the DM's Guild as a separate entity? Possibly. Could they create their own? That's also possible too. But I see what they're going to want is everything. And I think this isn't a surprise to me. All right? They're going to want everything that's officially one D&D published through their guild, their DM's guild, their storefront, and they take their cut. And maybe if they own it outright, they only need to take a 30, 35% cut and you get 65% instead of your 50% you're getting now. I don't know. I do know that they want that evergreen money. Now, who's that going to affect the most? In my opinion, that's going to affect the larger publishers of third-party publishing, right? It's going to affect the Frog Gods. It's going to affect the Troll Lords. They can still publish for 5e. That OGL can't be revoked, to the best of my knowledge. I am not a lawyer. But my understanding is the OGL is there. It can't be revoked. It can be changed, but you still have the option of writing under the OGL that you prefer. So if you write a new OGL, you can still produce material under the old OGL. Maybe, though, you can't produce stuff using the new SRD. Wizards of the Coast is like every other major corporation. They're not here for you. They're not here for me. They're here for their stockholders. And they need to find a way to make more money from 5e, even on the off chance that 5e or 1D&D, they need to make money off the 1D&D, even if that market shrinks. If that market shrinks, yet you control distribution, because remember, they are experimenting with physical and digital products directly through them as a bundle, and that bundle will include, I can guarantee, as my favorite Southern cook used to say, that was a fake accent anyway, but I can guarantee you that they're going to throw the VTT content in there too. You're going to get that whether you want it or not, but they want you to play on that VTT. Why? Because they want to, because it's going to have a, I'm sure it's going to have a monthly subscription, right? This is all evergreen. This is all work in the tail. This is all having a money source that even if we don't publish anything for 3 months, we still have money coming in. And again, if they get a 30% cut of everything that gets published for one D&D from third-party publishers, and they don't have to put any effort into that, that's pretty big. That's pretty sizable. So that's what I've heard, and I'm labeling it a rumor only because I can't name my sources. But my sources are damn solid. So the idea that there's not going to be an OGL, that there, but there will be an SRD, and it's going to be under a licensing agreement that isn't open, you can take that to the bank. Now, could that change? Certainly that could change. It changed with 5e, right? It took a little bit over a year, but they finally said, oh, they relented. It may happen with one D&D. I wouldn't bet on it, but it may. Now, there's also the aspect of you can probably still publish material for D&D for 5e without using the new little widgets that they're going to be adding to one D&D to make it different enough that it doesn't fall under the open game license, but it's still compatible with stuff published under the open game license. But, you know, this is the purists, right? They want to play the latest and the greatest. At some point, 5e, as it's seen now, is going to be old school gaming. Isn't that a kick in the crotch? Folks, live stream tomorrow night. Myself, Glenn Hellstrom, 8 p.m. Saturday night, myself, my wife, Rach, and other gamers' health. Other than that, as always, be safe, be well. God bless. Roll those dice, roll them well. And the endemic, use your common sense. There. We covered all the bases. All right, folks. I will catch you later. God bless. Be good.